Hello, everyone, and welcome to New Consciousness Review. I'm Miriam Knight, and our guest today is Alan Klein, a person who comedian Jerry Lewis once called a noble and vital force watching over the human condition. Alan is the world's only known jollytologist and the author of 18 books that have sold over 500,000 copies. Those books include The Healing Power of Humor, The Courage to Laugh, Learning to Laugh When You Feel Like Crying, Inspiration for a Lifetime, Change Your Life, A Little Book of Big Ideas, and the soon-to-be-published The Art of Living Joyfully. Alan is also a certified speaking professional designation from the National Speakers Association and a Toastmasters Communication and Leadership Awards. Alan, I'm delighted to welcome you, and I'm looking forward to a lot of fun.
Good. It's great to be here.
Alan, you call yourself a jollytologist. I love the term, but what do you do?
Well, actually, let me tell you first how I got that name. I studied laughter. I actually have a master's degree in human, H-U-M-A-N, development. And my thesis was The Healing Power of Humor, which turned into my first book. And because I studied humor, the Greek word for humor is jellos. So I tell people I'm a jellotologist, but then people didn't know what that was. They thought I made dessert. So I changed it to jollytologist.
I see. And, well, they say that laughter is...
I think people say, you know, at least close, you know, that it's close to humor, laughter, and play. And I, besides writing the books on the subjects and inspiring and motivational books, I also go around the country giving workshops and lectures on the therapeutic value of humor. And I just got back last week. I was in Memphis, Tennessee, speaking to 150 hospice workers. Mm-hmm. And in 2 weeks, I go to Boise, Idaho, speaking for their employees. I think there'd be about 250 employees of the Tumor Institute.
Wow.
So I speak a lot for the in the healthcare field and the hospice field, because those people are so wonderful, such great caregivers, but they also stress out a lot. Uh-huh. And I also do public programs, like I'll be speaking in Michigan next month, both for a hospice there and then also doing an evening public program.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well, they do say that laughter is the best medicine. And I understand that you're the recipient of a Lifetime Achievement Award from the Association for Applied and Therapeutic Humor. I never knew there was such an association. And is therapeutic humor a popular discipline? Are there a lot of other people like you?
Well, there are people like, see, I do mostly keynotes and workshops. So there are some people like me, but people are using the therapeutic value of humor in all kinds of settings, nurses, hospitals, teachers, to get their message across. Mm-hmm. So they come to the conference to learn how to do that. Clergy, again, you know, to get their message across. Nurses, doctors, social workers, one that has an illness and is looking at maybe techniques of how to get a different perspective on their illness, which humor always does. And then people in general, all kinds of people, because humor is so valuable in everyday life. And then we also bring in AATH, Association for Applied Therapeutic Humor, they bring in researchers to show that what we're talking about has some validity and that humor is very beneficial on very different and assorted different levels.
You kind of think that either a person has a sense of humor or they don't. Can it actually be taught?
Well, you know, my belief is we're all born with a sense of humor, Miriam. Well, what happens when we grow up? We go to school and we're told by the teacher, hey, settle down, get serious, wipe that smirk off your face.
I bet you heard that a lot growing up.
Yeah, what happens? We become a very serious adult. And yet that playful child is in within us. It still wants to come out and play. And studies that are showing that people who enjoy their work, that get some laughter in their work, are more apt to do a better job, more apt to listen to their boss, don't get so stressed out, burnt out, because they really have some pleasure in what they're doing. Mm-hmm. And so there's so many different levels where humor is valuable, even in the workplace. And that's some things that AATH teaches, but it's something that everybody needs to know. And yes, we all have a sense of humor, and sometimes, and we have to look for it harder than other people.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So how did you actually get into the therapeutic humor business?
Well, it started a very difficult time in my life. Little over 30 years ago, my wife went to the doctor just for a physical checkup, and he did some tests, and results came back, and the doctor called back and said, Ellen, I think we need to put you in the hospital. He said, we discovered some things I don't like. I want to do more tests. And he said, I think you have something called primary biliary cirrhosis.
Hmm.
It was an illness, a disease of the liver with the bile ducts all clogged up. And the doctor said, I'm really confused because women over 65 usually get this, and you're only 31. And so they did the tests, and the results came back, primary biliary cirrhosis. And when Ellen asked him about how long, you know, she has to live, he said 3 years.
Wow.
And indeed, Ellen did pass away 3 years later. And there were no liver transplants at the time. There was no hospice at the time, so it was a very difficult time for me, had a 10-year-old daughter, and it was very difficult. But during that time, there were a couple of things that happened. I remember Norman Cousins at the time. He had a rare disease that he wasn't supposed to survive, and he used humor to help him cope with it and get through that.
You know, I remember reading that in Reader's Digest a million years ago,
right.
How he actually just got a big stack of funny movies and watched them.
Right. Candy Emmerich, funny movies, funny books. And he actually had to check out of the hospital because he was laughing too much. And he credits his surviving his illness, which doctors said there was no chance of surviving, not only with taking the right medicines that the doctors are prescribing, but also with laughter.
Mm-hmm.
So my wife, I realized after my wife passed that she had a great sense of humor. I'll give you one example, Miriam. She was in the hospital with a copy of Playgirl magazine. And she had a picture of the male nude centerfold, and she said, Alan, I really like this hunky man this month. Can you put it on the wall by the bed over here? And I said, Ellen, this is a hospital. I said, it's a little risque for that. And she said, well, Alan, maybe you're right. She said, why don't you get a little leaf in the plant cart? And Miriam, I did that, and things are fine for the first day, fine for the second day, but the third day, the leaves start shriveling up and revealing what we're trying to conceive. And, you know, I realized looking back, it wasn't a lot of laughter. We'd start to laugh looking at that. It wasn't a lot of laughter. It was only 5 or 10 seconds, but it helped us rise above the situation. It gave us a little reprieve. It gave us a little perspective. It wasn't a lot, but I realized looking back, it was something that helped us get through the very difficult time.
Right.
And so when Ellen went back, when Ellen passed away, I did go back to school and got the master's degree and focused the rest of my life on teaching people how humor could help us cope about any situation.
I remember when I read your book, Learning to Laugh When You Feel Like Crying. That actually just came out a few years ago, didn't it?
Right. That book, My first book was The Healing Power of Humor, which is about human everyday situations and has 14 techniques of how to get some more laughter in your life, and we'll can talk about that a little later. Mm-hmm. The second book, I went a little deeper, and that was The Courage to Laugh, about humor, hope, and healing in the face of death and dying. And I went a little deeper, and I interviewed about 100 people who had either lost a loved one or had cancer or AIDS or dealt with lingering loss or sudden loss. And I asked them, did you find any humor in this situation? And about 98 out of 100 said I did, and I documented all of that in The Courage to Laugh. Mm-hmm. The book that you're talking about that came out last year, Learning to Laugh When You Feel Like Crying, came out because I realized when I realized that when I was grieving, either with my wife or more recently with a very close cousin that was like a sister to me, that when I looked for grief books, they were like 200 to 300 pages. Mm-hmm. And they told me about all these terrible things that I'm going to go through and how depressed I was going to be and how long and I might lose my appetite and, you know, on and on. And I thought, you know, there was no grief book out there that I found that was easy to read because I didn't feel like sitting down to read a couple of hundred pages. So that was easy to read that I can almost open up and get some encouragement for the day, and that helped me lighten up in some ways about the process. Mm-hmm. And so that's when I sat down and wrote Learning to Laugh. It's about embracing life after loss, and it has 5 stages of kind of how to go from loss to laughter.
I did notice that it was very easy to dip into, and each of the chapters was short and you know, gave you just that little lift. That was interesting.
Exactly. And the 5 stages I came up with, I don't know if you know about Kubler-Ross and her work in Death and Dying.
I didn't at the time, no.
Yeah, but she had 5 stages, and I thought, I want 5 stages.
If she can have 5 stages, I can have 5 stages.
I can have 5. Why not? And so my 5 stages are losing, learning, letting go, living, and finally laughing. Mm-hmm.